Time once again to check in with our Miami bureau chief, Bruce Smirnoff, who is covering Miami.
I got it all covered. Hey, listen, I had such a great time being on your podcast about 2 or 3 weeks ago. So many of my friends went on and listened to it. Just incredible. Thank you for the opportunity.
Well, thank you for doing this.
Love to be connecting.
And I owe you an apology because I forgot what a great, funny comic you are.
Thank you.
How far? You're in Boca de Burger? Boca Burger?
Yeah, Boca Burger. I live in Delray Beach, Florida. I'm like 38 miles from Miami Beach.
Okay. What's going on in the show business world? What big names are playing?
Well, as we spoke about last time, nothing is going on right now. Zero. I will be performing at Valencia Cove, which is an over 55 community. You don't even know, wherever you live in America and you listen, or whatever country and you listen to this, what you're going, what's over 55? Over 55 means you have to be minimum 55 years old to live in this community. And the good part about it is, like, if you don't like your neighbor, give it a week. Could be dead, could have a new neighbor. You know, that's the great thing about it. Like, let's say when I lived in West Hollywood, I had a barking dog situation, right? I knew I had to move because these was a young family. These were Orthodox Jews. You want to hear that story? It's a very interesting story.
Orthodox Jews in West Hollywood?
On Detroit Street. I guess it's not West Hollywood. Yeah, it's by the farmer's market. So that's West Hollywood-ish. You know, Detroit yeah. Street, La Brea, that whole thing.
Okay.
So I was active with Schwartzy, who just recently passed.
I know. You knew him? You knew
love
him?
Schwartzy. I used to do his Purim shows. I'll tell you a great story for any of you people, whether you like Jews or not. It's a nice story. And Schwartzy used to do a Purim show. At the
you're popping store. Your peas, so stop saying Purim.
Oh, Purim.
And don't say Passover. Don't say Pupik or Pesach.
Okay. So he did these shows at the Comedy Store every year for Passover, or for Purim. And I was the MC, and I would get the comedians. And the irony was, the Comedy Store is owned by Mitzi Shore, who was they call her the queen of comedy. And she was a great, great influence, helped develop, as you know, so many great people. But the thing is, she never liked me. In fact, she hated me. If she, in fact, I was synonymous with not funny. That's how bad it was. And yet she had to donate the room because all about the Orthodox Jews, it's all about giving and doing mitzvahs and donating. So she would donate the room and she really couldn't have a say in who was performing. So I would be on this show. I think we did about five.
She's not years. She wasn't an Orthodox Jew, was she?
No, but everybody, they're like, it's like rubbing a dwarf at the racetrack. It's like good luck if you do. I used to hang out, will not mention his name, with a big manager. And this guy was a psychopath, went to Hollywood Park in Santa Anita all the time. And I would accompany him. You know who he is, not gonna mention any names. But he had this thing, like a twitch before the races. He would have this nervousness and we'd be walking all around the racetrack, and I go, I can't tell you, but there was a African-American dwarf who used to shine shoes, and he would look for this African-American dwarf, and he would rub him on the head. I went, hey. Oh my God. He goes, this is what we did in Virginia. This is gonna bring good luck at the track. And I would sit there and go, I just watched this guy manages some of the biggest acts in Hollywood have to rub the head of a black dwarf. And this is, and then I would see Ray Sharkey. You remember him, that actor?
Sure, yeah.
I love the Idol Maker. And that was what made him a big star. And this was just like 2 years later. And he was a full-fledged junkie at this point. And he would walk around. This was in the Turf Club. You had to wear like a jacket and tie. And he would have all that on, but it would be misplaced. Like he'd have the jacket around his crotch and the pants over his head and the tie on his elbow. He was so messed up. And yet he was like a big star. I remember always seeing Sharkey there. But
yeah,
yes.
He dated somebody I grew up with. Who was the daughter of a comic.
And he gave her the disease, yes.
Do we know how she is?
Do you know she's still alive, thank God. and she has a you know, like a web page, and she talks about her her recovery from all that. So fortunately, knock wood, they have really made a lot of progress with those drugs. Yes.
Great. Her father was a very funny comic, and used to do the Ed Sullivan Show all the time.
No, her uncle was also a comedian up in the Catskills too.
Who? Well, let's not.
I can't. Certain things we don't want to talk about.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So then where were we now?
I don't know. The racetrack. Mendel Schwartz. I still get emails from him. He, as I remember, Mendel Schwartz was, I think, a Lubavitcher or a very Orthodox Jew. And he was instrumental in changing the attitude that people like you and I have towards the Orthodox Jews. He was very embracing, very loving, very, you know, he included everybody. Because, you know,
Mendel is the son of Rabbi, of Shlomo. Shlomo's the main guy that we're talking about.
Shlomo Schwartz.
And he was, from the story I've cobbled together, he
was... By the way, Shlomo is also what people called him as a put-down.
Yeah, but that's his real name. That's his name, Shlomo Schwartz. And so he was hired as the UCLA Chabad rabbi. And then at some point he got into a quabble with them. So he created this own thing called the Chai Center. And that was based out of his house. He has 12 children and the whole, and they would, his big thing was to put Jewish single lost people like myself in a room and try to get them to meet each other and then get married, hopefully, and have Jewish children. Because Chabad is different than all of Judaism, and they're an outreach, and they try to a little bit convert people to Judaism, where Judaism really doesn't promote conversion. But they do wonderful things, Chabad.
They have enough
even
people.
But I did lose it on them when they sued the Seattle airport, and I just said, boy, even the good people overstep it, because they had the Christmas tree. So of course the rabbi in Seattle, which is all Gentiles, he has to come in and go, I'm gonna sue it as though mezuzah. They go, what is a mezuzah, you lunatic? I'm gonna sue. So that was the end of the Christmas tree. So, you know, new Nazi party started in Tacoma probably, and all because of Chabad. But that wasn't Schwartzy, he was an outreach of that. Anyway, so Schwartzy has these, Friday night you go to his house, the wife makes dinner, and there's like 30 Jews there, and you try to hit on all the women, but you try to do it under a nice way. But the funny thing was, his wife, such a Olivia, still around, great woman, she would make this hummus, and the hummus must have had 800 cloves of garlic in it. So here you were trying to meet guy meet girl, and you'd eat this hummus and your breath was vomit on vomit. So you'd be standing, I would be in Mar Vista, the girl would be in Playa del Rey, and you'd be on a megaphone because everyone's breath was so horrible, you couldn't make a contact with anybody. So they tried, but I once said to Olivia, because, you know, we're having one of their singles events, and it was the most misfitted Jews, the missing links of Judaism, come to their house. And I guess me included. They liked me because I was funny. I kept it light. And I once turned to Olivia, I go, look at these Mieskites. These are unmatchable. Even if you go back to Fiddler on the Roof, no one would want these people. I go, what do you do when they hit like 50? And she just deadpan turned to me and she go, we shoot them. That's just hysterical. Orthodox Jew, we shoot them, you know, with that look, with the rolling of the eyes.
You taught me, and I always quote you, forbissen upon him.
Yeah.
You told me what a forbissen upon him is. Describe for my audience what a forbissen upon him is.
Interesting. My mother used to always say, don't make that face, you'll grow into it. And, you know, that's like an old wives' tale. And a Farbissiner, well, you see the movie Austin Powers, Frau Farbissiner. So, you know, they've got that. A Farbissiner is, to my understanding, and I could be a little bit off the path, is someone who's sour on the inside and it grows to the outside. And it's an amazing thing because I'm 60 now and I know people my whole life. And I know people who are like women who were like so hot when they were 14, 15, 16. Not that I was dating them, but they were in high school with me at 14. But I'm just saying people I knew when they were 14, how beautiful they were, but they were sour people. And now you see them like at 40 and the mouth grows into the downward pout and the nose droops down because their inside grew to their outside. And that's what a Farbissiner is.
Yeah, I've talked about that on the show before and you taught me. Are you working the cruise ships?
I got to finish the Schwartzy story.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's okay. So, Mitzi Shore, every time I go on and I kill at the Comedy Store, but I'm not, you know, she won't allow me to perform there. I kill. And every time I go to do my set, Mitzi gets up, leaves the room for this famous Purim show in the main room, 500 people. And I don't care because I just don't care because that's just my lot in life. And so one year, this is after we did it five, this is a beautiful story. You know, the rabbi calls me up with the wife. Oh, we're going to do it at the Comedy Store. I go, not a problem. I can't wait to help you out. We're going to have a show that's even better than last year. You know, the irony though, rabbi, is Mitzi Shore does not like me for whatever reason. And she does not feel that I'm very funny or anything like that. And I don't care, but it's just such an ironic thing. So, okay, I do the show. The kill, and I look over to where she was sitting, and of course, the chair is empty. She got up and left the room. At the end of the show, she's waiting for me backstage. When she got up to leave, the rabbi's wife grabbed her and made her watch me, and she had only seen me like 15 years before when I bombed in front of her on audition night, and there was Mitzi backstage going, I can't believe how funny you've gotten. Please call me tomorrow. And that was in 1993. And from that day until the day I left LA in 2001, I had the best spots at the Comedy Store. I had night of the week. I had main room on Saturday. So it's a beautiful story. And that was strictly because of the rabbi and his wife. So there was paying it forward. There you go.
Wow.
Now, what do you want to know?
Cruise ships. I have this fantasy about Florida. This is my fantasy about Florida. I never moved to San Francisco. I never tried to be the kind of comedian that I ended up becoming. Instead, I stayed in New York. I developed an act that was like a tank that could go anywhere.
Yes.
And now I moved to Florida. And in my 70s, 80s, life is good. I'm working the condo circuit. I'm hanging out at Wolfie's. Is Wolfie's still around?
No, that got bought by the guy that owns Jerry's Deli in LA. I'm blanking on his last name. I think it begins with a Z. And Jerry, whatever his name, Jerry Z. But no one eats that food anymore, not even Jewish people. There's just very few people can digest that horrific food. So it became what's called Epicure Market, which is like, what's the equivalent? What's the word Chasen's is in LA, where Chasen's was? Beverly and Doheny became that gourmet food market. So it became something like that, but it was so expensive, they didn't even have price tags. They just had spin the wheel. Like you'd go to the bananas and you go, what's a pound of bananas today? They go, let's spin the wheel. And it would go from $5 to like $9 a pound.
Really?
So they just went out of business. Yeah, I'm exaggerating.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's like a great market, but the prices were even too much for rich people.
So I notice like the Carnegie Deli, you go in there, there'd be like a slice of cheesecake. I'm going to do this just because we're talking about the Carnegie Deli, a slice of cheesecake the size of a Buick. Sorry, but, you know, Buick.
Yes.
Comedy would. People, Jews are not eating that kind of food anymore?
No. These restaurants, you know, there's a man I was listening to on the John Bachelor show, the radio show, and he wrote a book about the last delis. I forget what it is, but there's something like 17 delis left in the United States.
What are you talking about?
There's like 17 delis. It's a book. You can look it up on Amazon. It's called Delis or the Last Delis. And there's like 17 left where there used to be hundreds. I mean, listen, how many are in LA? Is Junior still on Westwood? We don't live in New York. And then there's Arts in the Valley. There was Langer's. Maybe Langer's opened up, but Langer's used to close at 2, or maybe they closed at 2:15. But that's not, you know, that's like only open for a few hours. New York, Carnegie closed. There's the Second Avenue Deli. There's the one that's down in the Lower East Side.
No, the Second Avenue Deli, I think, closed. There's one.
That closed too?
I think so. Listen, when you hire Al Goldstein, the publisher of Screw Magazine, to be the greeter at your deli, Katz's is still around.
Yes, that's the one I just went to a few months ago. But that's in that hip area. So it's supported because it's just so cool that it's a throwback. So, yes. But again, we're on one hand right now of delis. Down here, we've got there's 3G's down here. There's just like Ben's Deli. But this is a major Jewish area down here. And there's probably five delis.
Jerry's Deli in Beverly Hills, across the street from Cedar Sinai.
Right.
They closed.
Oh, there you go. That's what this book is about. You're questioning me. I'm telling you, we're coming down. You know, I was at Jerry's Deli one time, and they flew in Larry Hagman's liver because he needed a transplant. And it was like the biggest thing. You had like 100 press cars, you know, all the trucks with the satellites and the helicopter, and they were all filming the helicopter. And it came in, the guy came out, jumped out with the lunch basket, you know, with the dry ice in it. And they had the liver for Larry Hagman. And he lived on that liver for a long time until he passed away.
And
it's like the biggest thing.
Well, wait a second. So you went to watch the liver getting?
Well, it was at Jerry's Deli, and you could see all this action going on. It was, you know, it was, you could look right into Cedar Sinai parking lot from Jerry's Deli, especially from the chair I was sitting in. And that's what it was. Did I know it was Larry Hagman's liver? I think so, because the television was on. They were doing a live broadcast. So I just looked at the TV, said Larry Hagman's liver being delivered, and like just like Jerry's Deli delivers, and right out the window they had all the trucks and everything. Yeah.
Well, we're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we're going to talk about cruise ships.
Okay.
Welcome back. We're talking with Bruce Smirnoff. He is our Miami bureau chief.
That's so funny.
Tell me about the cruise ships. I've never done a cruise ship.
Well, I also have a day gig now where I work for an agency, and we're one of the top agencies in the world, and we book the talent on the cruise ships. And the name of the agency is Don Casino Productions. And Don was a great singer down here in that, when we were talking about the heyday of Miami, and Don was dating a beautiful woman named Candy, what was her name? Candy Scott was her show business name. And they got married, and they didn't want to go on the ships anymore. So Candy created this agency. Ships used to just mail away for your dates. That's how crazy it was. They were so eager to have entertainers 30, 40 years ago. And Candy created, the agenting, whatever, liaison down here. And then she has turned it over to her daughter, Wendy Garvis, and Wendy runs the company with Robin Cahill, and I work for them like as a talent liaison, which is a fancy word for I come in once a week and I tell them, look, here's some people to put on the ships. But it's a big job because we get like, I'd say 200 people a week want to be on cruise ships. You're asking me, what does it take? And you have to be really specific to work on cruise ships. You have to be everything that we were taught not to be when we were in the comedy clubs. You know, you're taught to be off the wall, edgy, push the envelope, all those things. If you do any of that on a ship, you basically could be fired within hours. So you kind of have to be vanilla-ish. You have to be kind of like everything else, but you still have to be great. So it's hard to, you know, to stand on both sides of the fence and describe it. But, you know, you have to be a little schmaltzy. And at the same time, you have to be really good.
Well, somebody, if you're at the top of your game, like Rickles, or he's edgy, but he could have played a cruise ship, I would assume.
Yeah, well, he's a star, so that supersedes everything, yes.
Are there any instances where a star does a cruise ship and people complain?
They used to. Oh, they used to use Norm Crosby a lot. They used Jerry Lewis. If you watch that documentary called Telethon, you can get it on YouTube. You ever seen that?
By the way,
just go to YouTube, type in Telethon. It's somebody made a documentary. It's like cinema verite where the camera is just on and it just follows Jerry Lewis. I believe it's the 1982 Telethon in Vegas.
Well, why didn't I know about that? I'm obsessed.
Oh, it's phenomenal. You got to see it. And you remember Ralph Cardinale? Remember when Rick Corso was doing Vegarama in LA and we were all doing little parts on it and Ralph was one of the henchmen? Well, Ralph was Jerry Lewis's like right-hand guy. We never believed him. And there's Ralph, this whole documentary, you know, as his right-hand guy. It's really
as we're speaking.
Yeah.
I'm looking up Telethon.
It's 2 hours and like 6 minutes.
It's not long enough.
Exactly. It's not long enough.
Telethon.
And it's amazing.
Hang on.
Yeah. Black and white on video. And it's telling because it starts like 3 hours before the telethon and it ends literally as he steps onto the stage. And it's the machinations that go on. But what's interesting about him is that he goes, which is what he was like.
How did I not know about
this? Oh, this is great. It's great.
It only has 15,000 views.
I know. And I've told everyone that will listen to me to watch this, and it's fascinating.
How can I not? As we're speaking, I'm posting it to the website.
Okay.
Hang on.
He's addicted in this documentary to ice, which I never. My mother said you eat two ice cream sandwiches, you're going to get your stomach pumped. I think he eats like 12 ice cream sandwiches in these 3 hours that at least they show on screen, and he washes it down with red wine. It's amazing.
Oh,
everybody has a peculiar, whatever it is the word I'm thinking of, but it's peculiar behavior. And yes, it's great. He goes like very serious. I need a shot. You have to put a 35 millimeter lens because he was very obviously very smart at this. And he is still living. And, you know, he's like, you got to use a 35. You can't use a whatever and a thing. And it's so. And then all of a sudden he sees Anna Maria Alberghetti and he just goes like whack job. And you're laughing. He's like, you know, it's an amazing mind. Amazing, amazing.
Oh,
mind.
I mean, I never thought Jerry Lewis was funny. And then somebody who I really respect said, go back to the 50s and look at this stuff. And I went, oh, yes. Okay, I get it. The guy's a genius.
Well, it's
the stuff that came afterwards that was funny, but for the wrong reasons. All right, it's now on my website.
All right. I never enjoyed him as a child. And because then I saw that documentary. I believe it was Cinemax did it. And I just changed my whole opinion of him. And I went back and rewatched a lot of his stuff. And again, it's not my favorite, but like The Nutty Professor is great. But just the talent and his ability and who he was and how famous he was at 18, you know, 19, I think 47, 48, the way they had throngs of people and they would throw their, you know, they'd be in a hotel like in Times Square and open the window and women would be screaming at them. That's pretty powerful. I mean, it was like Beatlemania in the late 40s. Pretty powerful.
All right. It's up on my website. Telethon, the entire movie, and it's under news from around the world.
Yeah, they
never, on the front page. You can
they
see
never,
it.
Like, they haven't blacked it out because I think the guy who did it never got paid or some crazy thing, so he owns it. And, you know, I keep waiting for them to take it down. They never take it down.
Wow.
So it's one of those
things. So you have this job. So who's the best cruise ship comic right now?
There's a few of them. I hate to mention names because if I don't mention someone's names, they're going to get pissed. But John Joseph, you must know John from New York. He is in very, very high demand. My guy, it's amazing. His name jumps out because he's very, very versatile. He can work what's called a mass market ship, which maybe has 6,000 passengers. So you've got people of all walks of life. And then you can put him on Cunard, which is like uppity, very high-end British and U.S. guests. And he will kill with them as he kills with a mass market ship.
But what kind of life is that?
What kind of life is that? It pays a lot of money. It pays more than any. There's nothing left on land anymore, unless you're in Branson, Missouri, or unless you're on television. So everything has been squeezed, and all that's left are the cruise ships. And they don't even pay what they used to pay 30 years ago when I hear what guys made then. But still, what they pay today is really good money, you know, and as we are speaking here on this podcast, I've got like three emails that came in the past 2 hours of people that want to be with us. Now, a lot of these people are lunatics. I mean, I had a guy, some of my favorite ones was a guy, because my last name is Smirnoff, he thinks he's got an in with me. This guy's like from Ukraine or something, and he's living in Staten Island, and he plays the balalaika, whatever that thing is. It's a triangle-shaped guitar, and he's dressed like a Cossack, which is always good to a Jew running from the Cossack while they're trying to have a pogrom. And he's in his basement. This is where he films it, on his iPhone, in his basement, and the wife is dressed like an Orthodox Christian, you know, with those hats that look like they look like cuckoo clocks. You know, they look like they've got like a 6 foot hat they're wearing, and they're playing. He's playing the balalaika, and she's playing the piano, and they're just singing. And this guy will not stop calling because he got my number. Smirnoff, ready to go on ship. Smirnoff, when I sail on ship, they pass by my window every day. I could just jump on ship, Smirnoff. And of course, when a guy is this insane, I got to call him back and go, we're working on it, Igor. We are busy, busy, busy. I can't sleep at night, Igor. Smirnoff, when is ship coming? So now, then I read a book about the Russian mafia. Then I stopped all of a sudden playing with this guy because people are going to come and fillet me like a Maui fish in the Delray Beach. So I stopped with the tormenting of the Ukrainians. That's over with.
You have done cruise ships. Have they all been?
Here's how it started. When I moved to Florida, I was edgy-ish, and I had, you know, dirty material, and so the condos got me clean, because you have to be clean. So the next step were the cruise ships, and I tried the mass market ships, where people are from all walks of life, and they didn't like me. My, you know, I'm a very funny guy, but it's not for everybody. It's ethnic. It's whatever it is, and I didn't do well. So I laid off the ships for a few years, and then I didn't realize, I never knew about these high-end ships where they're very wealthy people. Very wealthy people like me because they're very, very elderly, and I'm like a throwback to the comics. See, everything as you get older, you always remember your point of reference is when you got married. So that's why the music, if you're 80, you still like the music of the 1950s because that was your wedding song, and you got married, and you danced. You were still, you know, vibrant at that point. point in your life. So they remember the comedians that they liked were the ones they saw on the Ed Sullivan Show and the shticky and the take my wife, please kind of thing. And I'm like a throwback to that generation. So that's, I didn't know about those ships. So those ships exist. And that's what my act is still like. So I did it. So they found me. And my first ship is a Regent cruise line. Phenomenal. And they send me to Alaska. And I'm all excited. And it's a charter cruise of funeral directors. Only me, right? Did they send me on a cruise of funeral directors? And the most amazing thing happens. They introduce me, and I'm nervous because, you know, you know, funeral directors are not peppy people. They're not that they're party people, the opposite, but they're not, you know, they're very solemn people. They're around death all day long. So there's no energy in the room. And as they introduce me, the house PA system cuts out. It's being overridden by the captain. And I know this sounds crazy, folks listening, but I swear to you, this is all true stuff. They interrupt. Someone is dying in the showroom. So you get an interruption. You hear bong, 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 code blue, showroom, code blue. Code blue is a medical emergency. So I look. And as I'm coming on stage, so I can't even be heard because my microphone is automatically cut out, they're pounding on this guy's chest. And everyone is looking at them pounding on this guy's chest. And I'm just standing there. And then finally, the people start to look at me, and I don't know what to say. And the comic, the bad boy inside of me goes, hey, folks, look at it this way. Someone's going to be having a little extra business this week. And it was the worst thing you could see. It's funny, but it's the worst thing. And then I couldn't believe what I said next. I said, look at the bright side. You can write this trip off as a tax deduction. And they all got up like rows of corn. I would do a joke, row H, up, out. I would do another joke, row C, four, up, out. And I got fired. I mean, they fired me. So I told the agent at the time, the agency that I work for now, they were my ship agent. And I told them the story. They started laughing. I go, no, this is not supposed to be funny, but this is why they fired me. So they go, no, this is amazing, this story. So they had me call the vice president because this was, they made a big deal about it. They gave me like 20 weeks of work and they just fired me from all 20 weeks immediately. So they got the vice president on the phone. They said, tell him the story. So I very calmly told him the story. And this guy starts laughing and he goes, look, we're making an exception. We're putting you back on. And they put me back on. And I've never, you know, so now I know, because this has happened now three times where people died or they have fallen and they're bleeding profusely right as they're bringing me on stage. Now I know what to do. Now, you go on like at the Comedy Cellar in New York or the Comic Strip in New York, these great clubs, no one's rupturing, no one's having heart attacks, no one's having seizures because people are 19 years old in these places. But now I'm so akin to this, I know what to do. What would you do, David? I'm asking you, you tell me, what would you do if you were coming on stage, someone starts rupturing blood? What do you do? And everyone's watching the blood rupturing. What would you do?
Well, my instincts is to make fun of the guy.
Right.
So the last thing.
No, that's not what you're supposed to do. So we know that. You've got to rule that out. So what would you do?
Well, obviously, you just keep going.
That's one option, but that is a good option. But I've learned now there's two options. What you do, if the blood is gushing like over 6-7 inches, where it's like really bad, you go, we're going to take a 5-minute break, and you just walk off the stage. And, you know, it's stupid. You're laughing, but these are the kinds of, who knows what to do? I've learned what you do. Now, let's say it's not that bad. Let's say they're doing mouth to mouth, which I just had down here a few months ago. You just do what you do. You just do your act. And it's the most amazing thing. Human nature takes over where they know what's going on. You know what's going on, but both you and them are going to pretend nothing's going on. So they kind of laugh. You kind of do your act. They keep kind of laughing. You keep kind of doing your act. The person either lives or dies or they're taken out. And everybody, like, it's like a draw. When you can't beat the other person, you kind of shake hands and you go, this was like, wasn't great, but we're not going to tell anybody because we understand what happened. But nobody brought it up, so no one got hurt. No one insulted anybody. And we all live to live another day. And that's what, that's, it's amazing. It's show business. And this, you have to be skilled and versed at, you know?
What happens for the rest of the day? You're on a cruise ship. I have a friend who used to do cruise ships, and then he couldn't take it anymore. He said he would work one day a week, and the rest of the time was just spent waiting for the show.
No, it's killing time, but here's the big problem. Here's the worst thing. It's called the walk of shame. And it is very possible you can be on a ship for 7 days, sometimes even 10, and they put you on the very first night. And going on, and whatever it is, you don't have a good set. In fact, you stink. And you are now involved in what's called the walk of shame, because everywhere you go, these people look at you. Like, let's say you have a bad set at a comedy club. You're never going to see these people again. Mm-hmm. When Michael Richards had that problem at the Laugh Factory, technically in his mind, he was never going to see these people again. So that's the end of it. Unfortunately, somebody had it on video, so that was a problem. But on a ship, you have to see these people. Not only do you see them, you see them all the time. And they look at you and they make facial, like, you know, like if you see like a, like you see somebody with an arm, no arm, or you, they like look at you and you see them make a recognition, like, oh, that's that terrible comedian. And do you know how horrible? It's called the walk of shame. And what I do, it's happened to me about 4 or 5 times in my 10 years on the ships. I hide, you have to hide in a room, and you come out like after midnight when everybody is sleeping, and you go and you gather, like you find hot water and you make an oatmeal, and that's your meal. I mean, that's your food. And you go back into your room and you just hide there sometimes for 4, 5, 6 days until it's over. You're laughing. This is, it's a horror show.
But if you said to, if you said to me, if I weren't a comic,
yeah,
that all you have to do is one lousy show and then you get to hang out on a cruise ship for a week.
No.
It's not good?
Not when you're a sensitive. Listen, the whole idea of being a comedian is that you're off your rocker and you rely on love, fake love from strange people, which is the sickness that we are in. So when you know you haven't done what you're supposed to do and you know these people that are supposed to give you the fake sick love are now giving you real hate, it's not good. It's the absolute worst thing. It's the worst. It's worse than the bullies that caused you to get into this business in the first place. There are people literally walk down the hallway and then like 2 feet after they pass you, they are like, you know, within the, what is it called? Sotto voce. They go, that's that guy that stinks. And you hear them go, that's that guy that stinks. Oh my God. And then you're back to the room with the oatmeal and you're looking at the watch. It's 2 a.m. There's nobody up. I can run out on the ship. I can get a couple of things done. Oh my God. It's the worst thing in the world. So you have to be so good that you have to, that you cannot, you have to be bulletproof on these ships. Plus they'll fire you anyway. If you have a couple of bad shows, you're toast anyway, because these people write reviews about you. These passengers who know nothing about show business, who have never in their life even, you know, played a harp in front of another human being, are going on and going, we didn't think Bruce Smirnoff was clever or had any comeback, and it's all over. It's curtains. I'm selling big and tall clothing all over again. It's all over.
And if it goes well,
oh, then it's you know, it's phenomenal. Then you're like the star of the ship. Especially, I'll tell you a funny ship story. Do we have like 8 minutes?
Whatever you want.
Okay.
Whatever you want.
Okay. This is a funny ship. So I'm on a high end ship, and I've already done my show, and I killed. And I'm like, you're the hero when you, because you're the comedian. You're the only comedian. You're the go-to guy. Everyone is a rich billionaire, boring person, and they look to you as you're the, you know, you're the guy, the magic lamp that you're going to rub it and you're going to make them laugh. So they have tea time. So I'm up in the area for the tea time, and it's just a bunch of tables. It's like the bar, you know, the lounge. And I'm at the bar, and then there's a quartet playing these four. It's always four women from like Eastern Europe or Ukraine, and where they, you know, they're all big into music, and they're playing, you know, like they play waltzes and they're playing classical music. So this, I'm setting it up. So there's these two tables that are sitting not next to each other. They're apart, but they're in front of the quartet. And I just happen to know both couples, the two Jewish couples that are on the ship. There's not many Jewish people on this, but these are the two Jews, because they like to, the Jewish people like to show how, you know, we know about the arts. We have to sit close because we're going to give it the nod of approval. We're Jewish and we know what's good. And we're giving it the yes nod. So you're, you know, you've been blessed. Like the Pope coming in and going, good, works. So they're sitting there, and now I'm opposite them at the bar. So the quartet is in front of me, and the two tables are in front of me, and they're watching. So all of them are playing, you know, the Blue Danube. It's wonderful. And then all of a sudden, they play Handel's. I believe it was Handel, and it was a song that he wrote in 1740. But it became Deutschland über alles. It became the German national anthem. It still is the German national anthem, but, you know, Hitler took it up a couple of notches and made it, you know, like a big thing. So they start playing da 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 da, and one table of Jews gets up. I've never seen anything like it. They throw their silk napkins down. Stop! You will stop! I command you to stop! And these four Ukrainian girls, they're 20 years old. They don't know from Jew. They don't know from anything. They're just two passengers that are screaming at them, throwing their silk napkins on the ground. You will stop! And they just stop! And they're frozen in terror. And I'm going, oy vey. And what the other table, because you have to know Jews, the other table gets up and they go to the Jews and they go, they will not stop. They do not know that that was the Nazi national anthem. And they look at the women, they go, we command you to play that song again. And the other Jews are going, I command you to stop. And they're going, the two Jews, the four Jews are yelling at each other. The Ukrainian girls are sitting there, they're schwitzing now. They're in a drenching sweat because they don't want to go back to Ukraine. It's a horrible country. They're in war right now. They want to stay on a five-star ship. And I'm watching this. I'm going, oh, Jews on the loose. And now all of a sudden, the two Jewish couples stop fighting and they look at me and they go, Bruce, what do you think? And I'm like, I turned into, remember Ted Levine in Silence of the Lambs when Clarice Starling asks him for the business card and he kind of like comes around the corner and he just like hands her the business card and then zoop, I ran out of that bar so fast. That's all I remember. And it was just those four Jews standing commanding these four Ukrainians to not play. It was the funniest thing I ever saw in my life.
Remember Leon Klinghoffer?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Well, you know that joke, right? You know, that's supposedly the Peter Fogel story.
What?
You know, remember, there's that urban myth, and I don't know if it's true or not, but I think it is, but I cannot prove it, that he was on a ship. You know, Fogel's a wise guy, a Weisenheimer, and he did that joke about, you know, I was at the bar the other day and I ordered a Leon Klinghoffer, two shots and a splash. Helicoptered him off the ship. They didn't like wait to the next port. They sent a helicopter. So that's the urban story about him. And
tell the audience who Leon Klinghoffer was.
Leon Klinghoffer was on the Achille Lauro, which was a cruise ship. This was, I believe, 1986. This is the first instance of Muslim terrorism aboard a cruise ship. Hijacked the cruise ship and they shot. What are you laughing at?
Well, unless you count the baba ganoush that they served.
And they shot him. It's terrible. They killed him and he was in a wheelchair. It was like he was a defenseless man, but because they went through the manifest looking for Jews and he was a Jew, they shot him. So and that's it was great for Peter Fogel to then do a Leon Klinghoffer joke. And, you know, when you're not supposed to do that. But hang on
for 1 second about Leon Klinghoffer.
Yeah.
As I remember, every Jew I knew in public would say, this is terrible. They took a poor old Jewish man and in a wheelchair and they threw him overboard, the Achille Lauro.
Yeah.
Then in private... And it turned, I think his son was like a program executive over at Comedy Central.
Jeez, I did not know that. Well, listen, we can, when we finish this, we can Google it. But it was a terrible tragedy. And let me tell you something. The cruise industry, there are every year, more ships coming out. These ships, David, they hold 6,000 passengers, and the crew, that's not the crew. The crew is like 5,000. So you're talking about 11,000 people on a ship. It's bigger than some cities in the world. And they build these ships now. They have brigs. Because when you have 11,000 people, stuff happens. So this is the future of travel and entertainment and all-in-one packaging and all that stuff.
And with
so
the ice caps melting.
It's a terrible thing that happened.
With the ice caps melting, we may have to live permanently on cruise ships.
Well, that would, boy, that'd be a lot of comedians working, let me tell you.
are there people who live on cruise ships all year round?
There's a cruise ship called The World, and it came out, I don't know, like 10-ish years ago, and this was like condos where you bought a residence on the ship, and the trip traveled around the world. I think Oprah Winfrey was, and they had a supermarket on the ship, and you have your own, you have like a, not just a cabin, but you've got like a one or two bedroom apartment. So you've got your own kitchen. You can eat on the ship in their restaurant. Anyway, I don't think it took off. I've been in port with it, and I don't think it became the hit that it was. But yes, there are.
Could you live on a ship if you didn't have to perform?
Could I live on a ship? No.
How long could you stay on a ship before you went crazy?
I've been on 6 weeks in a row, and I did go crazy. I've never been the same. When I come home now, and I'm still affected by it, I have like a big apartment, and I just sit on my chair in front of the television set. You know, you get, that's one thing, when you work on a ship, your whole world is your laptop, your earphones, your portable hard drive, where you've got movies and TV shows and books, and your whole world is the lights go off, headphones go in, your life is on your laptop, and you go from, you know, book reading to movies to this to that. I mean, if you're a drinker, which I'm not, you can go get wasted. I guess you can do things like that, but these are all non-productive things. But, you know, whatever your life is, it's all in your laptop. Whether you choose to educate yourself or entertain yourself, it's tough. And the food can vary. Some of these cruise ships are the worst food on earth, and some of the food is phenomenal on, obviously, on the more expensive high-end ships.
I heard all they do is eat on these cruise ships.
Right, because it's free. So, I mean, you know, it's the Woody Allen joke, you know, what is it, horrible food and such small portions, you know, it's
the food is free. So you go to the restaurant and the food is...
The ships are exactly the copycat of the Catskills. It's as much food as you can eat on demand, anytime, and entertainment up the yin yang. And that's the formula of the Catskills, and just taken to the corporate level and done to the nth degree. I mean, when I say the food is terrible, I'm a snob, I'm a whatever I am. But, you know, there are people who don't have great palates, and they like anything, and to them it's good food.
So living in Florida, it sounds like you're happy.
I love it here. This is the greatest thing I ever did. Because when I was a kid, I grew up in Connecticut, isolated, and I didn't have very many friends because I grew up in such an isolated area, and I must have had such a defective part of me that I caused people to bully me. So I was bullied by the few people that lived on my neighborhood. So I had like a very sad, lonely childhood. Not looking for tears or anything. I'm just telling you the reality was. So I lived in this nice home, isolated. And like my mother, I love my mother so much. I miss her so much. But my mother was constantly concerned that I was going to get kidnapped. This is how Jewish mothers were. So I lived with a mother who believed that I was going to be kidnapped.
Because she didn't want to pay the ransom. She wasn't worried about you getting hurt.
So my mother would do things like, you know, like I'd go out to play. Well, I lived in an isolated area. And if I couldn't be seen, because she was from the Bronx, so she was used to that urban life. So if she couldn't see me, she was convinced the kidnappers had gotten the net on me and were taking me away to some location. So my mother would ring a bell. So no matter where I was, if I heard the bell ring, I'd have to show up at the house, go, I'm here, I'm okay. And then, okay, and then I'd go back. And, you know, so this was like, once the bullies knew that I had to respond to the bells, like Pavlov's dog, they would like tie me to the tree. And then that would cause my mother would call the police, and the police, it was just terrible. So I'm just trying to give you a nutshell why I like Florida. So I would come to Florida. We'd come to visit grandma in Miami, and all of a sudden I was around kids. There were, and I was funny. So instead of these nitwits, meanwhile, all these kids that bullied me growing up in Connecticut, they turned out to be junkies. Many of them killed themselves. These are the happy stories. I love telling them. Those morons used to tie me to trees to go, I think there's something wrong with these guys. I can't quite put my hand. Meanwhile, they were needling themselves like at 14 with heroin, and they were dead by 20. So I just happened to grow up around like four defective people that made my life miserable. Anyway, they're dead. I'm still here. Anyway, so I come to Florida and I have the greatest. I even got action down here. I got my first action. I met a girl. That was like the last thing was going to happen in Connecticut. So it was great. So I had all these wonderful feelings of Florida. And I left LA in 01 because LA was all about my career. And I realized in 01, it wasn't going to, sadly, was not going to go the way I thought it was going to go, even though I was absolutely convinced that it was, but it didn't. So then I went to Brooklyn. I think we talked about this in the last podcast. And in Brooklyn, I was a fish out of water because I was living in the mafia neighborhood and I couldn't handle the winter because I had like 23 years of no winter in LA. So I said, you know what? I'll go to Florida. And this is, I love it here. This is not a great place for show business because there's no comedy club. So there are laments. But other than that, and nobody laughs down here. Like I told you, all my friends are on medication, so no one laughs at my jokes. You're the only laughter I've heard other than the audiences in months. And but I live great. I just love it here. You should come and visit. You live in New York. You know, take a few days. You can come and stay here.
I don't take vacation. I don't know how to relax.
I don't either. But if you ever need to be down here, you can stay here at my place.
How do you relax? What do you do to relax? I don't even know the begin. I like reading to me or watching a movie.
I was a terrible student, and I educate myself. I spend about 3 to 4 hours a night reading and Googling. I'm just like walking around. I want to be tested. I take these tests on Facebook. I get 99%. It's amazing how much information. I don't know everything. I mean, I don't know. Like whatever, what was that period when the Renaissance? I don't know that much history. I'm good on like 19th and 20th century history and non-mathematical stuff. I love reading, you know?
Good for you. One more story.
All right, what do you want?
I don't wanna hear next week we'll ask you about Rich Jenny's wake. That's just
That was terrible. Yeah. That was just such a sad thing, yes.
But
I have a funny story about someone's wake. But yes, that was just a tragedy. You want to hear a story about a comedian that I can't mention, but it's a good story. But we'll call him X, or you don't like stuff like that.
Is it Pete Fogel?
No. It's a famous comedian.
Yeah.
But I won't mention his name. Okay.
Okay.
Paul Newman had a son named Scott who unfortunately passed away from heroin abuse. So they named a UCLA came up with a wing. It's called the Scott Newman Drug Rehabilitation Center. And I was a doorman at the Improv at the time. And when they opened this, they christened the night. The night was the following. You would meet at UCLA where you would cut the ribbon to the drug clinic. Then you got on buses and you were taken to the Improv to see X, who was the biggest comedian in the United States at the time.
What year is this?
I'm going to say 80, could have been 81. I'm not. All you have to do is see when the Scott Newman Drug Center opened up at UCLA. So okay. It's them. But this is the hottest comedian probably in the world. So
it's 7 o'clock.
Thank you, computer. So I'm the doorman, and what I didn't know about the Improv is everybody complained when you sat people, I would have to seat people. And everybody was always like, you know, I don't want to sit here. So it was a pain in the neck. So I knew all these big celebrities and all these big people were coming to the club. And I was like dreading it. And the buses pulled up. But because it was such a solemn event, you know, and Paul Newman and the whole thing, all these wealthy, high connected people got off and I just said, please sit. And everyone sat wherever I point. I said, you sit over there. They sat over there. No one said, do you know who I am? I'm not sitting over. So it was just this amazing thing. So I had the room seated in, I thought was going to be 30 minutes. I had it seated in like 9 minutes. So I'm killing time. And they're all getting ready for the show. And I go into the bathroom, and there had been a fight over the weekend in the improv bathroom. So somebody ripped the door off the stall. So there, you know, the toilet is exposed. So I go in to use the urinal, and X is on his hands and knees in front of the toilet, and X has poured, I'd say, close to 2 grams of cocaine on the top of the toilet, and he's there with a straw or a $100 bill, and he sees me, and he knows me. He goes, "Would you like some?" I go, "Thank you, I don't do that." And then X inhaled the entire, whatever, 2 grams of cocaine, and then went on stage for the christening of the drug rehabilitation center. And that's when I said, I don't know if I can stay a Democrat anymore. This is like, I can't believe what I'm seeing. This is like, and of course, 19 standing ovations, you know, and no one suspected that X was high. And there you go. There's your da 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 da. You know, that's when I realized, you know, when I've got stories of being around gay Hollywood. I mean, the things I saw people on sitcoms, guys from like the Dick Van Dyke Show in dresses, wearing a dress with a handbag. And I'm going, I can't believe what I'm seeing.
Oh,
I'm 25 years old when I saw all this stuff.
I think I know who you're talking about.
Shut up, Mel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do we cut that out or do we keep it in?
No. I actually researched him. He had no children. He's been passed away for a long time.
Yeah, but so if he was in the closet, we should respect that.
He wasn't in the closet when I saw him, believe me. He was wearing a purple, he had gotten heavy. So he was wearing like a purple drape, like a drape that they just cut a hole out of. So he draped a purple thing. He had a Chanel, a woman's Chanel. We better not leave this in. But he had a Chanel handbag.
All right.
And it was like, "Hi, how are you?" And I'm like, "Oh my God, it's Mel Cooley. Holy mackerel." You know, but yes. Oh my God.
I'm keeping that in.
Oh, you're keeping that in. All right, fine. He was a great actor, but if you can research him, he always played that. It was a great character. He was, you know, Lumpy's dad on Leave It to Beaver.
Wasn't he in the Billy Wilder, Jimmy Stewart, Lindbergh movie?
Probably, because yeah. When I did my research on him, he was in very serious roles.
He was a great actor.
He always played a serious guy, but you couldn't help but laugh because he was such a great actor. He wasn't trying to be funny. It just, they would always, like, they'd make him the funeral. He was like the comic relief in serious movies. But then his forte, of course, was comedy, you know, the sitcoms.
Please tell me he was happy at the party.
He was great. Yeah. That's when I used to hang around with, we'll call this guy X. And X was the big manager who used to take me to the racetrack. And X was gay, but X had children. And this is another podcast. You'll hear about how that crazy side of L.A. Boy, that was weird. That was weird hanging
around.
We all think,
I can handle it.
Right.
You hear about that stuff. And you think, I can handle it. And you get there, and you think you're handling it, and slowly but surely, your neurons in your brain break down, and you pretty much lose it completely eventually.
Well, I'm writing as we speak, I can handle it, because that, I'm not going to do it now, but when we continue this, that is a great line for the stories that deal with X, the gay person, because all these guys that I knew wanted to meet him because he was so powerful. And I said, he's gay. Something's going to happen. He didn't do that with me because he liked me for another reason, but it wasn't sexually, thank God. But I said, X is going to want his 5 cents worth. And it goes, all of them said the same thing, David. I can handle it. And of course, the stories end in complete comedy tragedy because they couldn't handle it. And then one guy peed in his pants. He got so nervous. I'll go into it. But some of them are very tragic stories. But if we want to go into that, we can
and
do
it. And now everybody you play for pees in their pants. Bruce Smirnoff is our Miami bureau chief. I'll talk to you next week.
Thank you, David. Bye-bye, everybody.
Hang on, let me stop tape. That was great, Bruce. We